Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our panel discussion this morning. My name is Lawrence Ypil. I'm a poet and an essayist from the Philippines. This panel was originally set to be moderated by Shivani, but she can't make it to Georgetown this weekend, so I'm taking over a bit. Okay. This is in many ways the first panel we have today in the festival. So welcome to the Georgetown Lit Festival. I hope you have, you know, I hope this panel gives you a sense of the things that are to come for the rest of the day and the rest of the festival. Today we have a panel discussion on longing and the desire for longing. And I'm just going to read the description of the panel. You know, we ask the four writers that we have today to delve into the mysterious forces that inspire them to write what they do, and the desire to keep exploring what is sometimes unattainable. In many ways, you know, the question of longing is really a question that's tied to the process of writing. And this morning, we hope to get a sense of the ways in which longing shapes the writing of these four writers, whether they in fact think of longing, how longing manifests in their work. More importantly, though, in relation to the theme of the festival, Hiraeth, and for those of you who were able to attend the talks last night, they bring to mind a kind of longing for, you know, Hiraeth was the longing for a homeland that is no longer there. And maybe one thing to keep in mind as we're listening to these writers is to begin to wonder the ways in which perhaps writing is a kind of homeland for some of them, the ways in which perhaps writing is a home, you know, a homeland that either is no longer there or never was there, perhaps, to begin with. What we're going to do in the coming hour is get some time to know the writer's work, so I'll be asking each of them to read an excerpt from their work and to talk about how longing figures in their work. After all the writers read, we will have a short discussion, and then we will open up the floor to questions. Okay, we begin today's panel with a writer from Singapore. Her name is Amanda Lee Koh, and she's the fiction editor of Esquire Singapore, editor of essay platform postcode.sg, and a 2013 honorary fellow of the International Writing Program at Iowa. She's the youngest winner of the Singapore Literature Prize for her short story collection, Ministry of Moral Panic, a book which for me is possibly the best book of short stories I've read by a Singaporean writer. If you haven't read it, it's great. It's crazy. It's great. This was long listed for the Frank O'Connor International Short Story Award. Her work has appeared in a number of both web and print journals. She's based between Singapore and New York, and she's working on her first novel. So let's welcome Amanda Lee Koh.
Is this working? It is. Okay. No, so Tishani and I were just talking before we started about how it's quite difficult to pick a piece of prose sort of out of context within, you know, within the scope of a larger story or a novel. But so in response to, I guess, the needs of the panel, I think I'll read from well, the same short story, but in two different parts, and one of which I actually just realized happens in Penang, where my mom is from. So yeah, I mean, I hadn't realized before this that I could read this part of it being here. So I'll do that, and then I will ramble on a bit, I guess, about, you know, ideas of longing. I mean, I don't know. It's like, it's kind of, it feels also that when we talk about longing, there's the possibility that it becomes a bit fluffy. So I was wondering sort of by the end of it, where we would take this discussion on longing towards, you know what I mean? Like, how do we long with rigor, you know? So yeah, and I was also wondering if we were going to approach it more, just sort of more, whether it was more based on like emotions of person or emotions of place, but then of course they are intertwined. So I think I will just begin and then we will ramble on some more. Okay. Okay, so this story is called Alice, You Must Be the Fulcrum of Your Own Universe. And so I'll read the beginning and then I will pause for a bit, which means like some pages have elapsed and you fill in sort of the blanks, but hopefully it makes sense. Okay. We're in the flyer, the one meant to trump the London Eye as the tallest observation wheel in the world, and she has started to hyperventilate. Each ride, each oscillation takes half an hour, and I look at her small, thin frame, her bony shoulders, her prominent cheekbones, and I wonder if there is enough breath inside her to hyperventilate for half an hour and come out intact. We don't have a plastic bag on us, but I do know I have to find some way to restrict her airflow, so I end up putting my mouth over hers. She breathes through me, breathes me in, breathes me out, and her sharp intakes of breath slow gradually. When she catches her breath, she says lightly, "The last time I was kissed for that long, I was 18, under a banyan tree." "Bad joke," I say. "Do you need a doctor?" We stand by the glass windows of the capsule and look out at the bay. Do you know that right under Marina Bay is a cesspool? The waves can't flow out to sea anymore. If you fall in, you need a tetanus jab. She keeps doing this, taking me to places high above ground. First, it was the cable cars near the port, a thing of my 80s childhood. Then the flyer by Marina Bay, then the hypermodern infinity pool on the 50th floor of the grandest hotel in Singapore with the basement casino, for which you had to be a hotel guest to enter. Her niece and her family, who lived in London, were staying in that hotel, and she was taking them around, but she had deposited them at Orchard Road for the day, and she had the spare pass key. Would I like to go to the pool with her? If you're feeling lucky, she said, we could go play roulette after. She was in a fluffy white bathrobe, as was I. My swimsuit was well worn. When I put it on, I realized it had thinned out in some unfortunate areas. I hadn't swum in years. I wagered with myself on the cut of her swimsuit. And what sort of swimsuit would I wear when I was 66? The answer was clear, which was that I could never imagine myself as the kind of 66-year-old woman who would still be swimming. We got to the deck, and she unfastened and dropped her robe in one economical movement. Her swimsuit was a simple black one-piece, turtleneck, cut in at the shoulders. I'd expected looser skin, but her flesh tone was not too uneven. She turned to me, and I fumbled with the belt of the plush robe. We slid into the large pool that overlooked the city, that appeared to merge with the horizon. We stared out at the city, at the monumental greenhouses by the bay, rising like a quicksilver beast from land that used to be sea. Does the city ever frighten you? Not ever. How do you know what I'm asking? Because I can smell your fear. Not me. I love change. Is that why you're beautiful? If you keep up with the times go gentler on you because there's less catching up to do? She laughed, chlorinated hand held up to her crimson mouth. Who wears lipstick into a pool? I like the thought. Now tell me, have you ever pantomimed a picnic across a swimming pool floor? So this is the pause. Okay, so that was in Singapore, and now since we're in Penang, we skip ahead to when these two characters are in Penang. I hope that would be an okay kind of like psychic jump. So. We'll go into it. Let me decide where I will end so that it will feel all right for me when it does end. Okay. Okay, so we'll actually still be in Singapore and then shortly after we'll be in Penang. This will make sense, trust me. So she's walking towards me with a Singapore sling in each hand. She has said to meet in the bar of the Raffles Hotel. It is late afternoon, and the only people who meet in bars in the afternoon are in the movies, but it comes so naturally to her. in her nude pantyhose and cream pumps and apricot dress, salmon lipstick. She's always about trying something new, something she's never done before, something I've never done before, or best yet, something we've both never done before. I'm never allowed to pay for anything. I've stopped trying. She adjusts herself on the bar stool with decorum and hands me the glass. I avoid the maraschino cherry while she pops it into her mouth and raises her glass. She plucks the decorative fuchsia paper umbrella from her drink and slots it behind her ear into her hair. We clink glasses and she withdraws from her handbag an envelope. Will you go away with me? Nothing fancy, just a weekend in Penang. We sold the land. They're tearing my childhood home down. I want to see it a last time, and I would love for you to come with me. I open my mouth, but she speaks again. If the dates don't suit you or you don't want to, it's fine. I just went ahead and got tickets first. You know how I am. I don't want you to think I was being presumptuous. We're in Penang, and she's holding the keys to a rented manual car, khaki-colored with faded blue suede seats. She asks me, what's your dialect group? Teochew. Kaki nang, she exclaims, pleased. What's that? She looks at me and clucks her tongue. Now look here, can't you speak a word of Teochew? Look at me, I speak beautiful English, but also Chinese, Teochew, Shanghainese, and Cantonese. Oh, lucky you. When I say this, she softens. Kaki nang means our own people. I say, that's really old-fashioned. She says, how do you mean? I say, it cancels out other people. She says, it does, but I'm happy to be closer to you. It's what we do as human beings, cancel and see what is left standing. I think I'll end there, and like we can talk through it, yeah. I mean, I don't know, do we go on reading first, or do I like ramble on about like the excerpt?
Do you want to bring up certain things that you know that have come across your mind as you've read it? Yeah.
I guess, but then I will just feel like I'm sort of monologuing. I guess, I mean, as the first person, you know, it kind of I want to set the right tone as well. But so I guess like maybe what I would say is that I think that ideas of home. And I mean, I guess in relation to the theme of the festival as well, just in our current times are just very fraught with just all the kinds of global movements we make. And I'm not sure actually when we long for something, whether it's, you know, it's the longing for the longing rather than the longing for the actual thing. So yeah, maybe we'll go on.
And your piece also brings to mind, you know, past longings. You know, when you talk about your family history,
right,
of having been in Penang, and, you know, the present Singapore,
right,
it makes me think, you know, there are longings that we might deal with when we're writing, but it's also possibly putting us in touch with longings of the past,
right,
longings of a previous generation,
Yeah. And that in a way, you can't literally access, but you might feel closer to somehow. And I feel like growing up in a place like Singapore, it was almost like the moment there was something to long for, it disappeared. You know, it's just like, oh, I was longing for this and now it's a mall, or like now it's a train station. So I think that kind of that longing also gets thwarted by the state. But then in place of that, I think it's quite often for the state themselves to then want to inbuilt a kind of nostalgia for reasons actually of like nation building, but even as they take away sort of the things that were possible to long for. Yeah, so I think this becomes confusing for me. And I don't know if it's like in Penang, I mean, and Georgetown is so charming, but I just wonder also with if there would be gentrification that would eventually change the way it feels. Yeah. Like where my maternal grandparents live in Penang is definitely not really like Georgetown, and it just feels that it can retain sort of its character more clearly. Yeah. So I wonder about just stuff like progress and gentrification and where that fits into the idea of longing as well. Yeah.
I mean, it brings up questions of official longing,
right,
versus personal longing. And especially like, you know, you bring up the idea when the personal longing sometimes doesn't match the official or state longing.
Right.
then there can be a way in which the state longing supersedes over the...
And I think the sad part is that oftentimes the state longing eventually catches up with the personal longing. And then you're told that it's okay now to long for this thing, but then there's nothing for you to long for anymore, because when you wanted to long for it, it was taken away from you. And then if you're being told that it's okay to long for it now, you're like, oh, all right, you know? So, yeah, but I don't know if this is sort of a regional experience or not, so. Yeah.
And we'll see if these themes touch on the work of the other writers too. Our next reader is many things. Tishani Doshi is an award-winning writer and dancer of Welsh Gujarati descent. She received a master's in writing from the Johns Hopkins University and worked in London in advertising before returning to India, where a chance encounter with the legendary choreographer Chandra Lekha led her to an unexpected career in dance. She's published 5 books of fiction and poetry, the most recent of which is The Adulterous Citizen. Tishani Doshi has won the Forward Poetry Prize for Best First Collection and the All India Poetry Prize. She currently lives in Tamil Nadu. Let's welcome Tishani.
Thank you. So I'm going to just read 2 poems, and when I think of the idea of desire and longing, I'm looking at it in a very, via the body, so in a very sensual, spiritual experience. And the 2 poems are sort of contrasting. One is written after reading a deal of Sanskrit poetry. There is a wonderful play called Meghdoot by Kalidasa, where the clouds act as a messenger between lovers. And the arrival of clouds signals a message from the lover. And so for me, this idea of longing, it hinges on the idea of separation. So you can only long for something when you are separated from it. The lover can only desire and long for the lover when he is not with the lover. And I was very intrigued by this, because to me it seems that the entire creative impulse comes from a sense of desire. You know, and of course, culturally speaking, we have different relationships to rain. But in India, the coming of the monsoon is a great moment of joy, and it's all about procreation. You know, it's the sky god and the earth mother and green shoots, and so there's this fullness and this richness, which is to do with longing. And this poem is written after a Tamil bhakti poet called Nammalvar, and these poets wandered around the country singing songs for Vishnu, but using the most erotic language to describe their spiritual feelings. And they're beautiful works, so I want to combine that idea of rain, of devotion, and of drowning. And so this poem is called Ode to Drowning. This is an ode to be sung in the latest hour of night, when rain clouds have gathered over shingled roofs and blue-skinned gods with magical flutes seduce the virgins to dance. For there can be no love without music, no rain without peacocks perched in branches of sandalwood trees, with plumes of angels and voices of thieves pleading for their loves to return. If rain signals the lover's return, then I am lost in the desert, like the brain fever bird, looking for images of you through mesquite and teak. For there is no sign of you or what I know to be as you, only clouds adrift in a vanquished sky, like vines of throbbing arms and mouths, drinking at the shore, intoxicated with the night. There are as many ways of yearning as there are ways for rain to fall, slow, incessant, gentle, squalling, melancholy, warm. It's that old idea of drowning in another to find the self, the compliance that water gives in form and depth to something else. But what if the humming bees are quiet and the garlands of jasmine have been laid out to dry? How long to wait for everything to turn heavy with flour, washed of dirt? It's desire, after all, that spins us, demands to be praised as if it were new, like the stillness before the first monsoon when the hymen of the earth is torn in two and the brazen smell of damp fills the air. Must there be surprise after we have thundered and rolled and appeased our thirst when the silence returns again? In truth, isn't it a waiting that never ends, like the chasm between the cycles of the world, between separation and union, longing and abandonment, and somewhere in the waning, isn't this what we're left with, the music of uncertainty, the aftertaste of rain? Thank you. Thank you. So this is, was a return for me to sort of rediscover, you know, Indian poetry and Indian tradition. And I wanted to read something more contrasting, which is, I think as an artist and as a person, my difficulties now with the idea of yearning is that we are not allowed to yearn. We are not given the space to yearn because we are so connected. There is no distance. We are connected via Skype, by messages, by cheap travel. And so it's very difficult for us to inhabit that space. And so I'm talking now, I'll read just a short poem about the nature of love as I see it and how very often, even when you're just beginning or midway through a relationship, you're already thinking about its demise, do you know? So it's a very different different motivation. And it's called Love Poem, but I refer to it as my anti-love poem. Love Poem. Ultimately, we will lose each other to something. I would hope for grand circumstance, death, or disaster, but it might not be that way at all. It might be that you walk out one morning after making love to buy cigarettes and never return, or I fall in love with another man. It might be a slow drift into indifference. Either way, we'll have to learn to bear the weight of the eventuality that we will lose each other to something. So why not begin now while your head rests like a perfect moon in my lap and the dogs on the beach are howling? Why not reach for the seam in this South Indian night and tear it just a little so the falling can begin? Because later, when we cross each other on the streets and are forced to look away, when we've thrown the disregarded pieces of our togetherness into bedroom drawers and the smell of our bodies is disappearing like the sweet decay of lilies, what will we call it when it's no longer love?
I love how the poems are, you know, it brings up the question of what is longing like in the age of social media? Like, you know, in the age of Facebook, where everyone seems to, you know, you can easily curb that longing by attempting to talk to someone instantly from, you know, halfway across the world.
Yeah. And I think that the more connected we get, the more isolated and alone we feel. I think this seems, there are a lot of studies being done on this, and this sense that no matter how many ways there are for us to connect to people. In fact, we're not having real encounters. They're all via a screen or, you know, increasingly so. And so what does it mean then for us to sit here and to read to you and to talk to you and to have conversations? I think this is why these kinds of things are important, because as humans, I believe we need those experiences, whether they be, you know, I'm talking about desire and longing in a very, the most basic way. But I think there is also a sense of longing for touch, longing for to hear someone, longing for companionship, you know?
And it seems you honor, I feel like your muse is waiting, you know, the process of waiting. You bring in a lot of nature images in your work, and nature seems to be a teacher, a kind of model for waiting, the way the land can wait for rain.
I'm a big fan of waiting. When I was 14, I discovered my mother's love letters to my father. I was snooping around, and my mother's from Wales, and my father's is Indian. And I had never realized that the story of their coming together was quite so Bollywood, you know. It was full of conflict. And it was only when I discovered these letters, because they never talked about it, and in those letters was the architecture of their romance, because here she was writing every day from Canada, and there was my father in Gujarat at this little cafe writing every day for 6 months. And the deal was, if they waited 6 months, they could get married. And they've been married for 45 years now. So my novel is essentially, celebrating this kind of love, because I think, yes, you should be made to prove yourself in some way. I feel idealistic about that. That waiting has the quality of finding not just the love, but also yourself.
So maybe later on, if the other writers want to respond to the things that we're bringing up, we can bring it up. Our next writer is also a poet, Stephen James Smith. He's a Dublin poet and playwright, central to the rise of the vibrant spoken word genre in Ireland today. Prolific performer, Stephen has appeared on stages around the globe. Okay, he wants me to stop and he wants to go straight to the poetry. Stephen mentioned that he just came from Singapore a few days ago to perform. Your poems, Stephen.
No. Sorry, Lawrence. No, thanks. I don't like bios. Better off just doing a poem, haven't I? Than talking about myself. Thanks very much for the kind invitation. It's lovely to be here. It's a real privilege to get to travel the world with it from writing a few poems, and it's a great privilege to share the stage with these writers. So thanks very much, Penang and Georgetown. I guess, as has been somewhat touched upon, there's different forms of longing, longing for love, for understanding, for sex, or as in my case yesterday, for sunscreen. Like, you can look at my head, I'm not normally this pink. But sure, you live and learn. And I was going to do a different poem. I was going to do a poem about my mother, but just in listening to the guys, and then obviously given the theme of the festival, the longing for home, I thought maybe I'd do a poem about where I'm from, Dublin. And there's obviously as well, there's talk of maybe trying to use your own native language. So obviously I'm speaking in English, which isn't my native language, but there's a couple of words in Irish in this poem. So just to preface that, Cead Míle Fáilte means 100,000 welcomes, and Changa is Irish for tongue or language. But anyway, and there's about 9 Joycean references in this poem. He looms large over all Irish writers. Anyway, so this is called Dublin You Are. Dublin. You are grey brick upon brick, full of tarmac and hipster pricks, just face it. All other places pale in comparison, you are more than some former Saxon garrison, Dublin. Your warmth came too late for John Curry, Dublin, are you even sorry, Dublin? You're divided by more than the Liffey. You said yes to equality, it's about bloom and time, yet Dublin you always proclaimed to cherish all, Dublin. Your panties are on Capel Street, compromising any papal feats, Dublin. Jedward, awkward. Dublin. You're more than a settlement on the paddle, but Dublin, what's the crack with coddle? It's shite. Why don't you just admit it, Dublin? You brought back Sam again. But when did you go from the clash of the ash to exchanging gold for cash, Dublin, Dublin, Oblina, Balia Oha Clea, and 180 other tongues your citizens are using to name you, so cave me to fault you to all. Dublin, where the power is held by too few in the doll. Dublin, when will you revolt again? 1988 wasn't your true millennium, despite the 50p's and milk bottles. Dublin, you're mine, but I'm happy to share you, Dublin. From RTE, TCD, UCD, YouTube, SIP to IFSC and Acrimony, as Timberbar STDs, ODs, 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 and OMGs. No longer the second city. Yet you play second fiddle to Google and Guinness to Facebook and unsocial to its Dublin. Look at yourself. Your tower blocks and tenements are an excuse for a solution. Dublin, come here till I tell you. You can be more than rapid dirt birds and banjax bowsies. An alright story, but yes, sure, it's all good. Jay's that scaldy, why go bally? McSawyer and the lawyer, Dublin, I cry for you. Dublin, you're a tough bastard, yet you're full of the softness of all the people on your streets. Margaret Dunn dancing on O'Connell Street, the Dice Man Tom McGinty Moyman on Grafton Street, Pat Inglesby with his poems, Westmoreland Street, and your Mollies, Malone, Ivers and Bloom, to Daly, Sally, Sandy Mounts, from the Gospel of Kelly, Drew, McKenna, and Sheen, the Borstal boys like Brendan Bean, to Galance rejoicing and Evelyn looking out to sea. Snow falling slowly on the dead and glass, Nevin, Glenn and Marquette, the ones strolling to Christy Brown, willfully controlling a foot to paint pictures and poems to your heroines, Brenda Fricker, the city's mother, and Maureen O'Hara, an enchanting other. Dublin, you are boom and bust, running wild and swift. Dublin, can I trust you? Dublin, your true blue was Harry Clark's cobalt. Dublin, from a thin Lizzie Dicey Roydy to a floozy in a jacuzzi God-fearing. Dublin, shooting down Veronica Gearing. Dublin, your bang bang, 40 coats, Zosimus, a blind street poet. Dublin, you were all of us, and all are yet to come. So let's go to the grave diggers and have a pint. Dublin, remember Stardust and all your waltzing lovers. Big Jim's arms are outstretched to arisen people, yet are we under the thumb again, Dublin? Your GPO columns are scarred from the crackle of gunshots, Dublin. Your CCTV will never yield your essence like the shots of Arthur Fields, man on bridge. You are the pool beg towers and the poor showers begging on Bachelor's Walk. Dublin, you're all talk, yet you have my attention. From Robbie Keane to Paul and me and Dublin's calling, ooh, ah, Paul McGrath, while some say up the rah. Dublin, bridging gaps with Joyce and Beckett and finally to Rosie Hackett, Dublin. Paddy Finnegan was forced to sell the big issue on your streets while Daffodil Mulligan was played the bell round beats. Dublin, you say the lish. Dublin, you're full of the Polish and Brazilian speaking Portuguese, and now the Chinese have turned Part Elm Street into Chinatown. Dublin, don't let them down. Dublin, don't forget. No blacks, no dogs, no Irish. Dublin, perish the thought of you being racist. Dublin, Kilcullen has fled the GPO and is heading for Monto. Dublin, your bay embraces despite the Sellafield Sea. Your mountains frame all your natural beauty. Dublin, a whaling banshee stricken with TB. Dublin, you're European, but you could be Craggy Island in disguise. Gabriel Conroy is heading west because of an epiphany. Just saying, Dublin, you only painted your post boxes green. Is the Abbey doing all you dreamed? Dublin, you're notorious for clampers, senators and seagulls, to Celtic tigers and septic tanks, to singing high aging Vikings. Dublin, come here, take me for a teddy's and a romantic stroll down the pier. Dublin, you're a dancing place, a sprawling space of villages and many faces on the edge of an island that's been eroded by the Atlantic, battling with being romanticized. Dublin, are you dynamic, struggling with identity, changing for the better, changing for us? Don't be scared to change. Don't be scared. We're with you. Always. My friend. My home. Mentioned 50 times in this poem. We live in you, with you, my city, Macree. I love you. Most of the time you see Dublin, you are me. Thanks.
Do you want to talk a bit about how longing figures in a poem like this? Because it makes me think of, you know, a longing for a homeland, and we all have different homelands. And listening to you, it made me think, what is there something particularly Irish about this longing. It is obviously a longing with and for and to Dublin. But I'm also wondering, is there something Irish too about the way this longing is happening?
I would be hesitant to say that because then it's just sort of a romanticization. I think we all have a longing to understand where we're from and to understand the people that makes, I mean, okay, the people that I'm referencing in the poem are very, I specifically chose them because they tend to be the subaltern. And I think it's important as a writer to make sure that you, in some way, if you can, try and amplify other people's voices. So that's what I tried to do within that poem, to understand my city a little bit more. But so in a sense, those people are unique, but I'm quite certain if you walk around the streets of Penang or Singapore, where I was before, wherever, you'll find people that make up the city, and that's all that poem is about. It's longing for me to understand there, but it's a very universal theme. Like, I bought these shoes yesterday from an elderly couple just because I wanted to talk to them. You know, like, I don't know, they must have been 70, and I wanted to get to integrate or to engage with Penang in some way by talking to these people. So I spent, say, there for about 15 minutes, like, trying on far too many shoes just to spend time with them. Mm-hmm. So, and I've been walking around, I've been making notes about Penang so I can take an understanding. I have a longing to try and understand the culture here a little bit more, you know. But I'd be hesitant to say that it's a unique sort of Irish slant. But you can disagree with me if you want, you know. Yeah, that it?
Yeah. Our next reader is Adriaan Vendis, who also refuses to let me read. But he's a, you know, some people, I'm reading this because some people may not be familiar with your work. But we will, yeah, we can go straight to the text.
I do it myself.
Yeah.
I'm very honored to be here, and especially to be here in a colonial building because I'm a colonial product myself. Can you hear me? Okay. My family is from the Dutch East Indies, now Indonesia. And I was raised in a house with repatriated people from the colony. And the majority of the people were brown people. My mother's first husband, my mother is a Dutch farmer's daughter, but she married to a man from the Banda Islands, Moluccan. And she got three beautiful brown sisters. These are my half-sisters, because her first husband was killed in the war, decapitated by the Japanese, and she was in a Japanese camp during the war. After the war, she came back because they were not welcome anymore. These people who were too near the Dutch government, all the soldiers from the colonial army, for example, the Anjin Belanda, they had to leave the new Republic Indonesia. I was raised in a house full of longing. There was about 50 people living there, and my mother and I were the only white persons. I was the pink little swine in the family, because my mother's second husband was Indo half-blood from Surabaya. Papa saya dilahirkan di Surabaya, that I can say in Bahasa. But the longing was very strong at that house, but it was never mentioned, because the only thing they had to do was to adapt to the new country. So longing was something you whisper that was in the house, not outside, not for the outer world. The outer world, you tried to forget your past, a lost war, a lost country, and you tried to adapt to the Netherlands, a country that also suffered from the war, and you even had to adapt to a new war, the war in Europe against the Germans. Your war with the Japanese, and then that painful war between the Netherlands and Indonesia after the war, the so-called Bersiap, all those things were not mentioned. You could not discuss them, only whispered in the house. Well, I wrote quite a few books about that past because I was a kind of ambassador in this world. I was the white boy in the white world, and I was also a pupil in the brown house, where I learned how to survive for the Third World War that was coming, of course. We were waiting for the Russians to come. And I also wanted to learn how to live like those brown children did, because they had a great experience. They lived in nature, they had walked under the palm trees, but they were able to survive in a camp too. So outside world, the white world, I was had to be a good pupil. And the inside world, I was learning from their experience. So it was a kind of double learning. But also, you had a responsibility to be a very good pupil because you were the future of your parents. But inside, you learned another world, and you could not share these two worlds. It was a very complicated thing. We were singing all kind of funny songs, for example, and they were on the melody of national songs from the Netherlands, but with other words, songs against the Japanese, songs mocking their presence in the colony. So I had one melody, but two different words, two different worlds too. And that's where my book Repatriated is all about. And I was asked to read one chapter in Dutch, well, which sounds very funny to you, it's kind of throat disease, but nevertheless it will be translated. I'll give a sign when I do so. Because the peculiar thing about the Dutch, the people spoke in the colony, it's a bit like the Indian English in India. As funny things happen to European languages, they got more a bit fried, a brown size, like krupuk. So it's great indignation, that kind of tone. The Dutch has that tone too, but I will not do it while reading now, but there is full of it, because my father talked with a very strong colonial accent. Where do I have it here? Sorry. Yes, it's called the photo album. Het foto album. Meneer Java slaat zijn foto album open. Het is maar een paar centimeter dik. En toch kan hij er helemaal in verdwijnen. In de weidse valleien, plantentuinen, brede rivieren, vulkaankraters. In de oorlog is hij al zijn foto's kwijtgeraakt. Later hebben zusters en verre tantes het verlies weer goedgemaakt en hem van alles uit hun eigen albums opgestuurd. En nu kan hij zijn jongen laten zien hoe rubber groeit en koffie en thee en hoe de inlanders fuiken zetten. Nee, hij heeft geen heimwee. Heimwee is zwakte. Hij wil uitleggen. De jongen moet er wat van opsteken. Kijken is leren. Hij spelt de namen uit flora en fauna. Hoe exotischer, hoe beter. Hij tekent vruchten, zaden, vreemde vinnen, wonderlijke snavels. De jongen zou het allemaal wel willen onthouden, maar hij draait de woorden om. Haspelt lettergrepen door elkaar. En als er iets blijft hangen, legt hij de klemtoon verkeerd en lacht de hele familie hem uit. Hij kijkt dus stil en volgt gedwee de gele wijsvinger van zijn gids. Wel voelt hij een bloedzuiger op zijn been als meneer Java vertelt hoe hij vroeger door de mangrovenbossen moest waden. En hoort hij werkelijk de golfslag onder de bodem van een vlerkprauw. Kopkracht, hij leert het al. En ziet hij deftig aangeklede mensen verzameld op kades en perrons voor bezoek bij de gouverneur, dan is hij blij dat hij hun witte schoenen niet hoeft te poetsen. Al bladerend vergeet meneer Java zijn aanschouwelijk onderwijs, zo noemt hij het, om telkens weer met zijn jongen het album op te kunnen pakken. Zijn vinger staat steeds langer bij de mensen stil, niet bij zichzelf, hoewel hij bijna overal opstaat, in zijn witte pak, rijbroek of uniform. Hij groet de mannen op de foto's, bijna allemaal dood. Sinds de vrede, gewapende vrede, volgens meneer Java, bestaat zijn familie grotendeels uit weduwen. Maar het album houdt iedereen levend. De doden lopen gewoon boven de grond, brengen hun paard naar de stal, schuiven een stoel aan op de veranda en heffen het glas. Ze luisteren naar muziek en stellen de oorlog uit. Als meneer Java een bladzij omslaat, hoort de jongen de lange rokken van de dames ruizen. Vroeger was gisteren minstens twee keer per week om van te leren. So there you see, you can learn something from the past. But the word longing is not used in the book, not once. The word colony is not used, the word Indonesia is not used, neither Dutch East India. It's a silent longing, but it's a very strong longing. And strangely enough, though I was a total outsider, I'm still longing for that experience the first 10 years of my life. I always say after that 10 years, nothing happened. My father died and my mother hid away all things from the past. So the Dutch East Indies, the colonies did not exist anymore. there was only a future, not anymore rice table or rice, it was potato world. So I'm longing for the rice. That's why coming here is a kind of homecoming, though I'd never been here. I was conceived in Palembang, but that, well, it's like a stamp in a dinky toy, but I was born in the Netherlands. But raised with that other tongue, raised with that other food, that's my longing.
Photos, photography plays a huge part in the, at least the excerpt that you
bring up. The little excerpt, because people did not have very much, but my family sent pictures to family in the Netherlands. Because after the camps, people lost everything, or in the, during the war. But then the people in the Netherlands gave back the pictures to the refugees, to the repatriated people. So they were a kind of, yeah, they could live their lives again showing the pictures. And I was taught to watch those pictures. And for me, it was incredible to see, the father of my sisters, my half-sisters, killed a tiger. And there you see the hunter with one foot on the tiger and his gun. So that was another world than the brave Dutch world of living under sea level, if you understand. We have no tigers over there. All the animals, the fauna, nature, all these words were in the photo album. For me, it was a secret world. So they did not talk about it, but I took them. And then there you have this father trying to learn you how to survive a camp. Because the war was over, but not in the house where we live. The war went on for the next 10 years. We were still living to survive the next world war.
There's 10 minutes left, and I want to give the chance for the audience. Yeah, let's give all of them a round of applause. Maybe we can begin with the writers first. If you want to respond to anything that each other brought up, disagreed, agreed, resonated with, I think we're all coming from different places, so I love how it's, we all seem to agree that longing is at least one thing we can all agree on.
It's a very broad theme. When I hear Mr. Trump, I long for nuance and soft voices. But when the voices are too soft, I long for a trumpeteer. I mean, you always want to be there where you're not, and you want to hear something else that you hear. At least that's a thing. I have a kind of inner voice that always is discussing my own surroundings. So there's a constant discussion. Where do I belong? What do I want to hear? And very often you feel alienated. You think you come from another planet. And perhaps that's a stronger feeling now than it was before. But then I try to understand, why do you feel alienated? So I feel alienated from that inner voice, if you understand what I mean. It's a constant discussion, but gives good material for writing.
Yeah, I'm reminded of a sentence by an Indian writer, Suketu Mehta, who wrote a wonderful book called Maximum City about Bombay. And in the book, he says, when I am in one city, I am dreaming of the other. I am an exile, citizen of the country of longing. And this idea of being in one place and dreaming of the other, for me, it's a very personal theme. I've written about it. That's why I've also stolen the adulterous citizen for my books. And also this idea of elsewhere, that you are where life is not, in a way. You are where you are away from it, and you want to get there. So this gap is a constant sort of space where, I suppose, in a way, I think we want to be in that place, because it's in that place that we are creating, we are exploring. So it's something that Anthony Grayling said yesterday also, this never wanting to be satisfied is a human impulse. And it is precisely from this reason that we write poems and novels and paint and all of the other things. Yeah.
I think for me, what's interesting is that just across everybody, but and also with the theme, sort of separating the idea of longing and the desire for longing, it's almost as if what is in between them is just that productive tension that we're talking about. And I'm sure that this productive tension, it really exists in every form, whether or not you're really thinking through it. And I think that it expresses itself in like so many ways that in which we probably wouldn't even know the full weight of how much that tension actually seeps into our work. And all these different avenues and threads of longing, whether it's, you know, it's expressed with sort of, well, like more nature and sensual-based stuff or just more sort of politicized stuff as well. So I think it's amazing how sort of the human condition sort of is underpinned by something that, you know, that we know that we can't reach, which kind of makes it touching as well. That you know, that we're really speaking about something unattainable in that sense. Yeah.
How you doing? I think I have a longing to speak to the audience to because part of this we were asked to talk about the kind of mystical forces that drives you to write. And if there's anybody out there that hasn't written or is maybe interested in expressing themselves in some way, I have a longing to encourage you to pursue that, because you don't know where it will take you. And like, you've obviously come here to engage with literature in some fashion, and I appreciate that you're listening to me now. But like, it's so important for me that I found a vehicle to express myself, and I suppressed that for long enough. And it's been such a benefit in my life, and I would really encourage every single one of you to get a pen and paper and write 5 lines every morning. It's a very simple thing to do, and you don't need to get it into a book. You don't need to aspire to, you know, have the ego to sit in a stage like us right now. Just do it for yourself and see where it takes you. It's so important to listen to your own inner monologue, your own longing. So please go and do that with whatever art form it is. So that's my longing to say that to you right now.
Yeah. And maybe we can ask the audience. I'm sure some of you have questions for these writers. Can we have the mic? There's a mic here. Please raise your hand if you want to ask questions.
Good morning to you. My name is Seraphine Anderson. I'm addressing this question to Mr. Van Dis. You mentioned that homesickness was only for the weak. What made you, what brought you to that conclusion?
I didn't get your question. That's the father says it. Sickness is for the weak, but he was very homesick indeed, but he didn't allow himself to be homesick. So, of course, if you are expelled from a country, chased out of paradise, you feel very, all your pride is gone. These people had no jobs, for example. They were living for the colonial government. My father was a soldier when he was 16 years old, came out of the war, totally ruined with a very bad health because he worked on the Pakambaru Railroad. He was torpedoed on a ship by the British friendly fire. That was my first English word I learned. 6,000 people on board, only 400 survived, so he was a guilty survivor. So he could not talk about his past, and he's lost his status. He lost his status like very often migrants do when they come into a new country, they have to build up a new future, their children are the future, they only live in a kind of past. But to accept that you had lost that, to be homesick, that was too much. So you adapt, and he adapted too, but there was a great pain. And the funny thing about children is they understand everything, everything is normal, but they somehow absorb the pain of their parents. So that's why second generation and third generation write about it. That's why we have now in Europe writers from Morocco, Turkey, Suriname, so workers that were imported during the 60s to build up the modern Europe we have. Their parents were workers, they did not talk about their past. The children talk about the pain of their parents and they write about it. So migration is a good thing for literature, and the pain of your parents is a gold mine for writers, and I write about that.
There's someone at the back, and then the guy.
Hi, good morning. My name is Timothy, I'm from Taylor's. I teach media. Thank you so much for sharing your excerpts of your stories. Listening to your stories, correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm getting the message and that the way you guys express about longing to the readers is as though you're reminding us to take stock and remember the good old times. Because I think in our busyness and in our daily lives, we tend to stay very much in the present, to be focused in the present, that we kind of forget that having this sense of longing helps us to love more, to appreciate more, to be aware of the things that are around us. Is that correct? This is directed to any of the panel.
It looks like I'm up. I don't think I was, well, for starters, I don't necessarily sit down to write about longing. I'm hamming this together as we go along. But I think while there might have been some nostalgia in the poem that I read, hopefully I brought it to a place where I'm looking for the future and to the now and to be unafraid of change and to know what has come before and to learn from that, as opposed to looking back with rose-tinted glasses. Because in Ireland, while I love Dublin and Ireland in many ways, it also frustrates me an awful lot. So I think there's a lot of light and darkness in what I read, and I wouldn't be inclined to encourage anybody to look at the past and not be critical of it and to live in the past. We've got to look forward. When I'm writing, that's what I'm aspiring to do, and I'm aspiring to try and be unafraid and open to what's coming my way, as opposed to being stuck in the past. Now, maybe I misunderstood your question, excuse me if I have, but for me personally, you know, it's nice to know what came before, but don't live there. And if you said there you're living in the now, sounds like you're doing all right, you know.
I think for me, it really depends on what you mean by taking stock, because for me, there's like an archival impulse within that. But and I mean, nothing wrong with an archival impulse, but I think that the impulse of the writer is perhaps more to create from the archival impulse than to archive in that sense. So for me, I think longing is just a toolkit, really, for a more acute way of looking at the world and of feeling about things, and it could be feeling about your feelings as well. I think it's something that sharpens, because I think for me, taking stock feels static, but then if you can put something dynamic into that stock taking that then produces something sharper, yeah, I'm sure that interpretation is completely valid in that sense as well.
I think of, I don't know that we all live in the present. I don't know if that's true. I think we are always skating around time and always negotiating our relationship to time. But when I think of longing now, hearing all this thing, I'm thinking it's more of the idea of plurality. So what longing allows us is the sense of other selves, other lives, other possibilities, which is why when it comes to the idea of place, which is what I was talking about earlier, it's the fact that in another place, you could be another person. When you are with somebody else, they make you another person. So that kind of longing is really about finding another self. And I think it's basically because we are filled with universes and multiplicities, and so we are looking for ways to experience that, and so longing is a very important part of that. But I think we can also resist longing at some level because we, you know, the dangers of it can be nostalgia, can be hankering for the past, can be spiraling into something that's not, yeah, bringing us forward as well, what you were saying.
I was going to ask about that because I love how this longing is a space of productivity. But I do wonder whether, you know, when the longing is for social change, when the longing is for radical, practical, you know, improvement of lives, I do wonder whether the dwelling in the longing, a kind of refusal of fulfillment, may also keep us from actually moving. I wonder about the negativity of longing. When do you know that the longing is no longer productive? That it.
For me, it's very productive because I lie all the time. I long for countries that do not exist, and that's a great longing. And I make it up, like my parents made it up. It's mythology. People remember things, long for things that are absolutely not true very often. If you find out the real documents of their past, the real longing of their past, it's painful, but they didn't talk about that. So it is one big island of storytelling, one big narrative, and you make a new narrative. So I play with longing. So for me, it's never negative. It's a source full of energy. But it's not true.
Larry, I really agree with you. So sometimes I feel that the language of longing kind of allows you to defer that conclusion. And because that's so seductive, that's not the language of action. But then the inaction becomes so charged that it becomes sort of, you feel that it's productive, but it's productive before an action can happen. But then if you are sort of enjoying yourself in that, you know, in that in the seduction of that gap of longing, then I don't know that you would, when the time comes where you really can do something sort of more concrete in that sense, will you take that leap? Because you might have forgotten the muscle memory of sort of taking action because you've just been used to the language of longing as well. So I don't know about, I mean, I don't know what could I mean, what we could do to make it more productive, to be more like a monsoon, you know, where it collects and collects and collects and then it pours. So I don't know whether that accrual of desire can lead to positive social change and action as well, but I think it's what we have to hope for, right? Because I don't know, like the world is just a tough place, you know? And I think that words do bring us together in this kind of longing in which we understand each other better. But I do hope that it really can come together and produce something else as well, so that the longing will one day sort of accumulate into something that is beyond itself, yeah.
And maybe on that note, I mean, time may never come, but our time has come. For this panel, let's all give them a round of applause. And if you feel like, you know, continuing the discussion, I'm sure they would appreciate if, you know, I'm sure they will just approach them throughout the festival. We hope this sets the tone and it makes you, and it brings the questions that you bring in the next 3 days. Okay? Thank you very much.